Hello everyone, myself Mr. F.R. Sayed. I work as an assistant professor in the Department of Computer Science and Engineering at Walchand Institute of Technology, Solapur. The topic for my today's lecture is flow shop scheduling problem. Now at the end of this session, the students will be able to solve the flow shop scheduling problem. Now, as we know, the processing of a job requires several distinct tasks to be completed. Now, taking an example of computer programs, the computer programs generally run in a multi-programming environment, and these are given as input to the machine, which are first executed, and after the execution, the jobs are queued for output, and then their output is printed. Now, for flow shop scheduling, there are n number of jobs where every job consists of m number of tasks. That is, for a job I, we have tasks T1i, T2i, T3i up to Tmi, where I ranges from 1 to n, and the task Tji is to be performed on processor Pj, or is to be executed on processor Pj, where j lies between 1 to m. Now, the time required to complete the task Tji is small tji. So, we are expected to schedule these n jobs, and the scheduling is nothing but assignment of the tasks to the time intervals on the processors. And a basic condition is, on a processor, no more than one task could be executed at the same time. Now, processing of a task Tji where j is greater than 1 cannot be started until task Tj minus 1i is completed. That is, for a particular job, if we have two tasks, the previous task should be completed first and then the next task can be executed. Now, n jobs, each requiring m tasks, are to be scheduled on the m processors. So, this is what is our flow shop scheduling problem. Now, the schedules that could be generated are: first one is a non-preemptive schedule, and the second one is a preemptive schedule. Let us see what these schedules are. A non-preemptive schedule is nothing but where the tasks are processed on any processor, and those tasks are not terminated until the task is complete. So that means once the task is started on a processor, it will be completed at any cost without any other task interrupting it. But whereas the case for preemptive scheduling, the processing of a task on the processor may be terminated sometimes and another task may be assigned to the processor. So this is the difference between non-preemptive and preemptive schedule. Now, the finish time Fi of s of a job I is the time at which all the tasks of the job I have been completed in the schedule S. Now, similarly, the finish time F of S, that is capital F of S, of the schedule S is given as F of S is equal to maximum of small Fi of S, where I ranges from 1 to n, meaning the finish time of the schedule is calculated as by considering all the finish times of the jobs in that schedule, and out of those, which job has the maximum finish time, that maximum finish time is the finish time of the schedule. Similarly, we have another term, mean flow time of the schedule S, which is given as 1 by n into summation of all Fi of S, where I ranges from 1 to n. This is nothing but the average of the finish time of all jobs. Similarly, we have some other terminologies. An optimal finish time OFT schedule for a given set of jobs is a non-preemptive schedule for which F of S is minimum over all non-preemptive schedules S. Now, similarly, as we had an optimal finish time as in the case of non-preemptive, a preemptive optimal finish time schedule for a given set of jobs is a preemptive schedule S for which F of S is minimum over all preemptive schedules S. So these are nothing but the optimal finish times for the preemptive and the non-preemptive case. We have an example where two jobs have to be scheduled on three processors, and we are expected to find the schedule of the non-preemptive case, that is the non-preemptive schedule we are expected to find out, and the following matrix gives the task times. So this is nothing but we have two jobs, that is these one column indicates the task times of the individual task for a job. That is, this first column indicates that the first task will take 2 units time, second task 3 unit time, third task 5 unit times of job one. Similarly, this is for second job. Now these we have to schedule on three processors. These tasks have to be scheduled on the three processors. Now, since the first task of the first job requires 2 time units, it has to be processed on processor P1 since it is the task 1. So it will be processed on processor P1 from time unit 0 to 2. Now at the same time, we know that for second job, there is no time requirement on processor P1. So hence, we can say directly the task 2 of job 2 can be started. So it will be started from this point at time instance 0, and it requires 3 time units, so therefore it will be scheduled on processor P2. In the meanwhile, after finishing this, the second task of job 1, that is T21, is scheduled on processor P2, and then the third task of job 2 is scheduled on processor P3. And finally, the third task of job 1 is scheduled on processor P3. So this is the non-preemptive schedule S for the given set of jobs. Now here, the finish time of job 1 is calculated as the point at which job 1 got completed, that is time instance 11. So hence we have the answer as F1 of S equal to 11. Now pause the video and answer this question. Calculate the finish time of job 2 in the example. Now the answer is, when you see job 2, we have two tasks, that is T22 and T32. So the last task that we need to say is at what time does it get completed. So it gets completed at time instance 5. So therefore, F2 of S is equal to 5. That is, second job gets completed at time instance 5. The finish time FS of the non-preemptive schedule S is given as FS equal to max of FI of S, where I goes from 1 to N, that is max of F1 of S comma F2 of S. This is equal to max of 11 comma 5, which is equal to 11. So this is the finish time of the non-preemptive schedule S. Similarly, now that matrix that we had, which gives the task times for the two jobs which are to be scheduled on three processors, we are expected now to find out the preemptive schedule for it. So we start with the first task of job 1, which will be processed on processor P1, and the task 2 of job 2 is processed on processor 2 for 2 time units. Now task T21 is arising. Now task T21 is scheduled on processor P2 for 3 time units. Now remember one thing, T22 has time units 3, but we are interrupting it or preempting it after 2 time units. So that means 1 time unit of execution is still pending. So that will be done later, as shown in the diagram. So here we can see the task T22 is preempted and priority is given to task T21, that is task 2 of job 1, and it is executed on processor P2. After that, the remaining task, that is T31, is executed on processor P3. And finally, the task T32 is executed after execution of T31. So here, the priority is given to the task of job 1. So here also we can see job 1 ends at time instance 10. That is T31 ends at time instance 10, and T32, that is job 2, ends at time instance 12. So the finish time of job 1 is F1 of S equal to 10, and finish time of job 2 is F2 of S equal to 12. The finish time, that is capital FS of non-preemptive schedule S, is equal to max of Fi of S, where I goes from 1 to N, that is max of F1 of S comma F2 of S, which is equal to max of 10 comma 12, which is equal to 12. And finally, we see an application of this flow shop scheduling. An application is where we are having N machines and M jobs are to be processed on it, and we know that each job requires N operations to be executed, and ith operation will be executed on the machine I. And another condition is no machine can perform more than one operation simultaneously, as well as the operation within one job must be performed in a predefined order or in a specified order. The main aim is to determine the optimal schedule. An optimal schedule is one which takes minimum amount of time. This is the reference. Thank you.